Thank you. It is so good to have you join with us again at this same time. And again, we count it our privilege to be able to come into your homes and to spend this time with you. We do hope that you have your Bibles out as we continue now in our Bible study in this tremendous book, the book of Revelation, and God pre-writing the future before it ever comes to pass. We don't have to go to the astrologers. We don't have to go to the tarot cards. We don't have to go to these procrastinators here upon the earth that are nothing more than controlled by Satan and demons and try to predict and to tell the future. But when you began to look into some of these today, these astrologers and so forth, and some of these that claim to have special privileges from God, you find out that God has written in the Bible what he wants mankind to know. And these others are nothing more than imitators. They are phony, and they usually give predictions in generalities and not in specifics. But you must remember something, that when Satan uses individuals that are not spirit-filled, they are not spirit-guided, they are not believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, although they say they are, they do not believe the Bible. If they believed the Bible, they would be teaching you what God said in the book of Revelation and his prophecies and not trying to influence you that God has chosen them and given them some specific insights that he never wrote in the Bible. All of that is satanic influence. All of that is diabolical, contrary to the Word of God. What God wants you to know, he is putting in the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation. We find out in Hebrews 10, we find out in verse 7 that he says, "For Christ I've come written in the volume of the book," not in seances, not in giving spatial insights and ESP to all of these people who try to claim something that they have an insight with God that you don't have, something special. You might as well throw that stuff away. But you must remember, when Satan uses people like this, he will do everything when they make a prediction to try to bring it to pass, to deceive you that this person has some great special miracles or powers with God that you don't have. And that is exactly how Satan works. And we're going to see that here in the book of Revelation, where in the 13th chapter, he deceives those on the earth by the miracles which he does. So we're over here now continuing here, and we'd like for you to have your Bibles open, as we say. We'd like for you to follow along, because that way you learn. You study the Bible for yourself, and we'll recapitulate just a second. We had in chapter 6 the seven seals. And then with the seventh seal, we find out that opens the seven trumpets, which we're at now in Revelation chapter 8. Then as we move on, we'll have the seven vials in chapters 15 and 16, and then the seven thunder, or the seven thunders in chapter 10. But we're over here to chapter 8 now, and we'd like for you to follow along with us. If you remember now, we had here, and notice here in verse 2, "And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets." And then God begins to open up these and call them forth and put this trumpet here with this angel and say, "Go down, here is a judgment upon the earth." Now, you know, the Bible teaches that when the world, and we've tried to have peace in this world by everything that mankind can do, but there is no peace. There never will be peace until the Prince of Peace, the Lord Jesus Christ, returns to this earth, sets up his kingdom, and rules it from the seat of David over there in the rebuilt millennial temple in Jerusalem. And he will rule this earth where there will be perfect peace. And that's spoken of many times in the book of Isaiah. There'll be perfect peace. There'll be wars no more. They'll beat their swords into plowshares. And each man will have a tract of land to make a living. There will be no more hatred. There will be no more tolerance of rape or abortion or murder. There will be absolutely none of that. But God has given man the earth for almost 6,000 years, and he's made a total mess out of it. And yet God, on the seven, is God's perfection number. And when Christ comes back and sets the kingdom up for that 1,000 years, it is the only time you're going to find where there's perfect peace, because we have the peacemaker. And trying to solve all these problems without doing it the way that God said in the Bible is the reason we have all the turmoil that we have today. And you know, it's an amazing thing. We hear, I listen to the news report quite a bit, because I'm very interested in it, on the philosophies of men that they come out and what they're doing and so on and so forth. But you know, you'll hear one report. Well, murder and violent crime is down. 2 days later, you hear it. Over in Minneapolis, teenage crime and bad crimes are up 100-some%. And you hear these contradictory things in one thing or another. But do you know, in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 8, verse 11, the Word of God says, because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore is set in the hearts of the sons of men to do evil continually. A very simple principle. You find the violator, you have the evidence, they're convicted in court, then you know what? Get them sentenced and get it over with. We find this goes on for a year, 2 years, 4 years, 5 years, some on death row for 15, 20 years, and you just drain the money when these men are murderers, cold-blooded murderers, and yet God said, and he teaches in the Bible, capital punishment. And he most assuredly does. Clear back in Genesis, then whosoever sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. But when you turn from God's word and think you know more humanistically through the laws, the senators and the legislatures and so forth, we're going to do what we think, and we're not going to do what God says to have a safe national entity where the innocent can walk down the streets at any time of night and not be molested, not be robbed, not be killed. And yet, because of man's supposed philosophy going against the Word of God, the criminals walk the streets and the innocent have to stay home. Isn't that amazing? But if we would do it God's way, then we wouldn't have that problem, you see. But we're in a society today where we do not want the Lord. You know, oh, we go to church on Sunday morning, but we don't want to listen to what God says to do. And it's an amazing thing to me. Let me just give you an example. But just write down. We have people that go to church, never carry their Bible. You see them in the bars on Saturday night. They'll go to the preacher and ask forgiveness on the next day or Monday after they have their big fling. They have a filthy mouth. They tell dirty stories, but they go to church on Sunday morning. This is the kind of phony baloney that people laugh at. And I might say this, even society. But when you find that this kind of hypocrite and hypocrisy that takes place, the church is nothing more than a front, especially in your liberal churches. But the Word of God is not taught. The Word of God and principles and morality and things that have substance to them to make a society fit for people to live in, where they can function humanistically by the power of the Word of God and have that kind of safe society. But when you have legislatures and you have churches that seemingly do not want to preach against sin and are afraid to name it because somebody may quit their church who is a big giver. And after all, that's all right, as long as they give their money, well, you go sit in the bar, you go tell your dirty jokes, and your filthy mouth runs through the community, fine. But go to church Sunday morning, and you can rest assured that preacher is not going to preach against sin. If he did, you would find out that person would either be convicted or they would do and try to control their sin. They would try to live the way that God wants them to live, or they would leave that church. But when they go to that church and they're comfortable, you can rest assured that as a liberal church, there's no conviction, there's no preaching, just go through a few ceremonies and send them out, leave a few bucks in the offering plate, and you're all right. And that's what we have today in a lot of your modernistic and your liberal churches today. Don't preach against sin. Just preach. We're going to have communion. We're going to have this. We'll do something that's not going to be offensive, you know. But over here to Revelation chapter 8, this is why God's pouring his judgment out upon the earth. After the rapture takes place, these are the judgments. Now, if you recall here, you begin to find out that last week we had covered here that these plagues here, for example, in verse 7, the first angel sounded, there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast to the earth, and a third part of the trees were burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. It's going to be pretty hard to graze cattle and so forth. God puts here in verse 8, the second angel sounded, the second trumpet, as it were a great mountain burning with fire cast into the sea. A third part of the ships became blood. We believe this possibly is the Mediterranean Sea. You ought to check and see, and you find out a lot of warships are over in around the Mediterranean. There's going to be a lot of nations that are going to lose battleships over there. They're going to lose submarines. They're going to lose their Navy fleet. And a third part of them are going to be destroyed. Notice here also, in verse 10, A third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. And the name of the star is called Wormwood, and a third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. It reminds you back in Exodus again, doesn't it, in chapter 7 to 11, where the water was turned into blood, and nobody could drink it at all. And we come down here to verse 12, and the fourth angel sounded, and a third part of the sun was smitten, and a third part of the moon, and a third part of the stars. So as a third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. Now, when you have darkness, you're going to have crime. We already have crime that is unbelievable. But you know, we want to liken this back here again to the book of Exodus here, because we find out here that God has already done this. And he's saying, hey, if you don't believe the Old Testament, and the Bible tells us that these things were written for our learning and our admonition, but if you don't believe the Old Testament, well, then you're not going to believe that I predicted the future and these plagues are coming out against the ungodly. They most assuredly are. You know, it's an interesting thing when it says here the name of the star is called Wormwood. Do you know that God names the stars? He most assuredly does. And he names every one of them, calls them all by name. He sure does. And tells us that in the book of Psalms. He names every one of them. In Psalms chapter 147, in verse 4, he said, he telleth the number of the stars, and he calleth them all by their names. And you know what? God owns the universe, and he owns this earth. And you know what? He created you because he wants you to live with him for all time and eternity, but you must be born again. You must have a new birth. This first birth is corrupt, and there's no amount, and you know, it's an amazing thing. You'll take a little tiny baby that's just born, and you'll have your liberal churches that go in and baptize that baby. You know, it doesn't matter what you do with that old nature. You pour water on it, you pour vinegar on it, or you pour olive oil on it, or whatever. That old nature, when that child grows to the age of accountability, and as they grow, that old nature begins to come out. I don't care how many times you baptize that baby, how many buckets of water you pour on him, how much sprinkling you do on that little baby. I'll tell you what, they're still going to pout. They're still going to lie. Yes, as they grow, you're going to find out even your child lies. And you're going to find out you're going to have the same problems, doesn't matter how many times they've been baptized, as any other child who hasn't been baptized, as they begin to grow and they begin to grow. I've never seen a school yet where a parent has sent them to a school to teach them how to lie, to teach them how to use mother against father. And when the child wants something, mother has a soft heart. They go to mom. Dad says no too often. So they begin to know how to use mother against dad and dad against mother and so forth. And whoever taught them to stamp their feet and throw a temper tantrum, I don't know any school around. I've never heard of a school my age that ever says, well, teach your child how to misbehave. Well, you can baptize them, baptize them, baptize them, baptize them. They all have the old nature. It's not baptism that gives you a new nature. It is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and after that you believe, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And you are then given the Holy Spirit. That Holy Spirit is what enables the believer to lead the Christian life. But when you have people just going to church, you know, they're not born again. These liberal churches, they're not born again. They don't teach being born again. They're trying to get them to change by pouring water over their head instead of getting the Spirit on the inside. And you only receive the Holy Spirit by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. So it is that power by the Holy Spirit that enables the Christian to get out of the bars, to clean up their filthy mouth, to clean their filthy mind, and not be standing around wanting to go with the crowd and tell some dirty story, you see. No, those people that go to church Sunday are not born again. They're trying to, by the water baptism, they're trying to have a changed life, which it doesn't take place. Instead of being born again, believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, it is Christ that forgives the sins, and not something else. But we go on back here now, and it's sort of interesting. We come on back here to the book of Exodus here, and we're going to look at this here just a second. We come on back here, and how that they parallel these plagues that are coming out, and some more that are yet to come. We'd found out back here in Exodus 8:7, where the Lord here had set frogs upon the earth here, and that was the goddess Hewitt, which was pictured as the frog, since the frog was a symbol of resurrection, showed God was greater than that. And then in chapter 8, verses 18 and 19, the lice and the flies brought defilement. Then in chapter 9 of Exodus chapter 9, we have the murrain, and Hathor was a cow goddess, and Apis was the sacred bull, and yet these were sacred to the Egyptians, but it showed that God was greater than their false gods. And then we found in chapter 9 of Exodus here, 8 to 12, we have the boils, the hail, and the locusts. And the gods and goddesses that controlled health and safety were attacked. It showed that the Jehovah God was greater than all of their false gods. And now what we had read over here in Revelation chapter 8 about the darkness here. And that was the most serious, of course, because Egypt worshipped the sun god Ra. And that was chief of the gods. When the sun was blotted out here for 3 days, and let's read it here in Exodus chapter 10 here in verse 22 and 23. And Moses stretched forth his hand toward heaven, and there was a thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. And they saw not one another, neither rose up any of his place for 3 days, but all the children of Israel had light in their dwellings. Isn't that amazing how God can take care of that? And how God can do that? And he put darkness over everyone, show that he was greater than the chief of their gods, which was the god Ra. And then one other was the firstborn. That's interesting. Because if we go to the 12th chapter here now, the last thing, you've got to remember, 7 times did Moses go unto Pharaoh saying, "Let my people go." But he would not do it. He didn't want to let them go. He wanted to use them as slaves and so forth, would not listen to God. "Who is your God," he said, "that I should let these people go?" Well, you're going to find out, Pharaoh, who is this God? And we have people saying that today. Who is God? You know who is. Shirley MacLaine says, "No, I am my own God. I'm not subject to a God who you claim created this world and this. I don't believe in all that stuff. And I'm my own God, and I'm going to be reincarnated, and I'm going to come back." Well, this is satanic delusion of the mind. And this is exactly what these people want you to believe if you're listening. But we want to point you to the Word of God, the true God, the one that has the power over life and death. In Revelation 1, the Lord Jesus said, "I'm he that liveth, and I was dead. And I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys," get this now, "of hell and of death." Whether you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ or not, and I might say this, it almost taxes your imagination. I've had people tell me, "I don't believe there's a hell," and that's what Jehovah's Witnesses teach. They do not believe there is a hell. They'll tell you there is no hell. And Mormonism, same thing. Many of the other cult religions, same thing. We do away with hell because we do not want to hear about hell, And I don't believe there's a hell, I've heard people tell me. And, we tell them, because you do not believe there's a hell, do you actually think God is not going to change it? He said hell was prepared for the devil and his angels. And he said, if you're a child of Satan by rejecting the Lord Jesus Christ, you're either in one or two categories. You may be a nice person in town, but if you've never accepted Christ, you belong to Satan. You're a child of Satan. It doesn't matter how nice you are. Doesn't matter how wealthy you are. Doesn't matter what your standing in the community is. You're either in one or two things. You're a child of one or two people. You're a child of God. And you become a child of God by John chapter 1, verse 12. "As many as received him," that's Jesus Christ, "to them gave he the power to become the children of God, even to them that believe on his name." Now, you may go to church every Sunday. You may be a big giver. You may be looked upon in the community as some fine person. But you're a child of Satan if you've never been born again. You've never put your faith in Jesus Christ. Then you're going to go with your father, and that is Satan. And John brings that out. Christ spoke of that in John chapter 8. But you're a child of Satan, and he's going to give you the most devastating words you've ever heard. "Depart from me, you're cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels." So you either have God as your father, Jesus Christ as your father, or you have Satan as your father, and there is no intermediate in between. And when you die, there is no one. You go straight to heaven, or you go straight to hell, one of the two. You do not go to purgatory. It doesn't exist. In fact, Roman Catholicism now, in their new encyclopedia coming out, has done away with limbo. And I asked one priest here quite some time back. I said, "Why did you teach all these people for all these years a lie then, if you say now, and you don't teach limbo, you taught them for all these hundreds of years it was a limbo, then you must have lied to them. Why do you not teach it now?" Of course, limbo was never in the Bible to begin with, and it was vainly puffed up in the fleshly mind. But these are questions you need to ask, and these are questions that come out. This is what religion does to you. It promotes things that men sit in a little council and make up that are contrary to the Word of God. They're not in the Bible, and yet people sit there and listen. And I asked a man here some time back, I said, "What Bible do you carry to church?" He said, "I don't carry one. They have them there." Well, that could be true. Maybe they do. But, you know, God wants you to carry a Bible to church, and then you're not going to be deceived. If someone would have said, well, what about limbo? You say you attack it. I'm not attacking anything. I'm just saying this is what. If somebody teaches a lie, then that is it. Then let's expose it. I think I have a right. When I talked to this priest, I asked him, I said, you know, first of all, why did you teach limbo for all of those hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, and now you don't teach it anymore? Now, what are all of those people hundreds of years ago that they were taught there was a limbo? Now, it's not in the Bible, so don't look for it in the Bible because you're not going to find it. But now, you're not going to teach it. What happens to all them people? Now, either it was true or it was false. Well, of course, it was false because there never has been a limbo. Never has been a purgatory. Never has been. Are you attacking? No, I'm not attacking. I'm just simply saying this is what the Bible says, and here's what a church teaches contrary to the Bible. No, I'm not attacking. I'm exposing. The Bible does it. If I couldn't say, hey, it's not in the Bible, well, then I would be attacking because I'd be making it up myself. God is the one who attacks any false religion when you compare. And that's why he tells us in 1 John chapter 4, in verse 1, try the spirits, that is, judge the spirits, judge what is taught, so you're not deceived, you see. I wonder, I'd like to talk to some of them people 600 years ago that probably are in hell today because they taught they were going to a place that never existed. And their faith was in that, not the Bible now, because it's not in the Bible. So what are you saying? I'm saying, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, now shall be saved. Better to put your trust in the Lord than in his confidence in men. And that's the middle verse of the Bible found in Psalms chapter 118, verse 8. But let's go on here in our time left here now, and we want to bring out the last one here, the last plague here, which we're going to find out. There are going to be many people killed in the tribulation period by these judgments that God pours upon men. On the counterpart of that, you're going to have the Antichrist that's going to kill many Christians that belong to God. But remember this, you're either a child of Satan or you're a child of God. And only a child of God, you must be born again. And that second birth is a terminology used for believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Saved from what? Saved from spending eternity with your father, the devil, because now you are freed from that. You are freed from his power, his influence, and his where he's going to go. You're freed from that. You're passed now from death, that is the second death, unto life. You're freed from that. You're freed from the penalty of sin because you've accepted your sin bearer, which is Jesus Christ. Now you're freed from having to pay for your sin. And, of course, Satan's old destiny is already sealed, and he is hell-bound. God created hell for the devil and his angels, and it's there for all of those who will follow him. And when you say, well, I'm a good person, I'm a nice person, and I'm not following Satan, if you've never trusted Jesus Christ, you most assuredly are. And you've been deceived because he wants you to be nice. He wants you to be good. He wants you to go to church. He wants people to think good of you. And it'll appeal to your intellect and it will appeal to your pride that you're all right because your confidence is what people think of you in the community instead of believing what God said that you are a sinner. You don't want to accept that. You don't want to hear that. You don't want to hear I'm a sinner. But God said you are. In Romans 3:23, we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the wages of that sin is death. In Romans 6:23. The wages of that sin is death. But you don't want to hear that. You're trusting really in your admiration or the admiration of people toward you. And you suck it in. You love it. You suck it in like a sponge. You'll die and spend eternity in hell if you don't turn to Jesus Christ, realize you're a sinner, and Christ is the only sin bearer. Your only hope of heaven is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, accept his payment for your sin, and then you're passed from death unto life. If you've never done that, you're a child of Satan. Hell is the destiny. Let's go here and see here what God did here to the firstborn. Over here in Exodus chapter 12, I'd like for you to notice now, if you will, in verses 21 to 23. God had given this indictment here and promised, then Moses called for all the elders of Israel, and he said unto them, draw out you and take a lamb according to your families and kill the Passover. That was a type of Christ. And he said, you shall take a bunch of hyssop, that's the hyssop of faith, and dip it into the blood. Our faith is in the blood. We are cleansed through the blood. That is in the basin. Strike the lintels of the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin, and none of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning. For the Lord will pass through and smite the Egyptians, and he seeth the blood of the lintel. He shall, on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come into your houses and smite you. And then we come here to verse 29 and see the fulfillment of this here. And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat upon the throne, unto the firstborn of the captive, and that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of the cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and his servants, and there was a very great cry in Egypt, for there was not a household that there was not one dead. No one is exempt. No one. Then he go on down, and he called Moses and Aaron by night, and he said, Rise and get you forth from among my people, both you and the children of Israel. Now, there's something very amazing here, as we're going to see, that Pharaoh, you talk about a deceived man, you know, and he said, get forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord as ye have said. Now, here's what he said. This is amazing to me. Also, take your flocks and your herds, as you have said, and be gone, and bless me also. I can't believe that. I can't believe, O Pharaoh. You know what? He did know that God was truly the God and the creator of the universe. He knew that. He said, bless me also. Why would he say that if he did not know there was a God? He willfully rejected the God, but he wanted God's blessings. No, Pharaoh, you have no excuse. And let me say to you as our time has slipped away. You know what? You have no excuse. The Word of God is here. John chapter 3, verse 16, For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You have no excuse. You are responsible for the decision that you make. And we hope and pray that you will make it to put your faith in Christ and have eternal life and have the peace of God that passeth all understanding. Been so good to be with you. We hope that you will write us. Let us know that you're listening. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at the same time, may the truth of God's Word keep marching on.